Hello and welcome to Digital Exposure TV. Today I'm going to show you how to do 3D textures in Blender. Okay, so as you saw in the opening video there, I'm going to show you how to do three-dimensional texturing in Blender. Now today I'm going to do it in Blender Render because there's so many tutorials of how to do it in Cycles Render. I thought not everybody uses Cycles or not everybody likes Cycles, especially if they have a lot of problems getting rid of all the tiny little white dots. Okay, so I've opened up a new project here. I'm going to delete this cube and we're going to add a plane in there in a moment, but first, before we do anything else, we're going to open up Crazy Bump. So if you haven't downloaded Crazy Bump, which I think if you just Google Crazy Bump it comes up at like crazybump.org or .com, this is what's going to create our texture maps to create the texture. Now once it's open, it'll open up in a box like this on the top right here, and see this little symbol of a hammer and a wrench. That's for the settings. If you click on that, just make sure that normal map y-axis is selected to up, because otherwise Blender has trouble trying to read the files. Okay, so if we go down to the bottom left of this box where it says open, now we don't need to bother with any of these files because they're for the maps that we haven't actually created yet. We just need to go to open photograph from file. So we click on that and we'll use our rock texture, which is what I'm going to be showing you today. And okay, it's thinking about it. There we go. Now it gives you two different options. One of them is inverted and it basically shows you the depth of the image. So we want the one on the right here because it's extruding the sort of bumps of the rock. Okay, and now it will show you this preview. Now for something like what we're gonna do today, which is a very flat based texture, we're gonna click instead of ball to box. So we've got a flat, I'll click there to stop that from moving. So we've got a flat texture there. And that box is just on the bottom right hand corner here. You click on it and you can either have a ball, column or box. And if we go to options on the left here, you can show the different maps. So there's the one with the actual picture on top of it. We'll take the picture off and then we can see the colored light. We can take that off and so on and so forth. Okay, so here on the right hand side we've got various different tabs. We've got the normals tab, and the normals is basically this purpley image here which affects how light hits the texture and how things interact with the texture in the 3D world. Then you've got your displacement, which is what we're going to use today, which is the map that raises and lowers certain parts of the texture based on the image. So if you've got a lump in the image, it'll make a lump in the texture. That's the most important one. Then you've got occlusion, which is all the dark spots that tells the computer to dip in the dark areas. Specularity, which tells the computer basically how much light reflects off it. So if you can look over here on the preview, it's quite shiny. If I go to brightness and turn that down, there's less light shining off it. See? And you don't want too much because obviously it's supposed to be a rock. So that's about right. Then you've got your diffuse map, which is basically your original color photo. But we're going to use the diffuse map as opposed to the original color photo because it matches up absolutely spot on perfect to the displacement, the normals and the other maps. So you can fiddle around with these settings here. You've got intensity and you've got all sorts of things like fine detail. I'll turn that right up. But today, all we're gonna use is the displacement map and the diffuse map. So if I click on the displacement and turn the depth really high up, you'll see it looks a lot more 3D now. I can move the light around there. And if I just move it around, you can see it's a lot more three-dimensional. change the intensity on the normal map. The normal map's always on the top here, despite which tab you click on, and then it's on its own on normals. Okay, so we want this to look like a rock. So let's get the image up so we get the sort of final looking thing there. And that looks a bit too rounded to me, I have to say. So let's open up the displacement, turn the depth down a little bit, go to normals, and all these other maps do affect the displacement, even though we're only using the displacement. So you still can fine tune some of these things. Turn that down a bit. Oh, that's a little bit too much, I think. There we go. I suppose that's okay, isn't it? It's not amazing, but this is just a tutorial. Okay, so now we want to save these maps. So I've clicked on the Displacement tab. Click on Save. Save Displacement to File. It'll give you a location. I've got Desktop. And then it gives you a name. You can name it whatever you like, but by default, it will pick the original name of the picture and then add Disp for Displace on the end of it, which is what we're going to use. And then you've got your diffuse. Click on Save and Save again. And if you're doing this on Windows, when you click Save, it gives you the option of saving all the maps in one go. Now the Diffuse, which is your original picture, that map is called Color whenever you're using it. So there we go, I think we've just saved it. So if we quit Crazy Bump now, go back into Blender, we now have our two maps that we're gonna use. Now to start off, we want to make a plane. Now you can obviously use your texture on the top of anything really. It could be a person or a wall or anything you like in your scene. But what we're gonna do now is a helpful little tip. When you want to import a photograph or a texture and you want it to be the exact same size and shape, you can use this add-on. So if we go to File, User Preferences, click on Add-ons, type in image into the search. There we go. And there's two options. The one option you want is import export, and then it says import files as planes. So instead of importing in adding a plane and then importing the picture on top of it, we're actually importing the picture and it creates a plane for the right size. So we go to add mesh. Instead of plane, we go to images and planes. And then it gives us which image we'd like to use. So we're going to use Rock Texture 7 Color Map. Now to see the maps, if you see this little icon here with four squares, that actually gives you a preview of what you're clicking on. So I'll go to Import Images as Planes. And now that, if I go to Texture Mode, there you go, you can see our texture. But it's completely flat, which is pretty kind of dull and nasty looking in any production really. So we'll go back to solid and we have to make sure that this is clicked on, and we'll press tab and that opens up our edit menu, and now we need to press W and add a subdivide, which is at the top of the menu there. And once we subdivide, it only goes into quarters. So if you come over to number of cuts in this corner here and you type in how many subdivisions we want, I'm going to pick 30 and enter. And then what that does is it separates it into little tiny sections, if you can see there, like a grid. And what the effect of that is when you add your subdivisional surface modifier so that you can basically change the terrain of the plane, it won't just completely turn it into a squished ball of Play-Doh. It will actually just round the edges off instead because it's preventing it from squashing it down. Okay, so press tab to tab out of that, and now we're going to go to this little wrench thing over here and we're going to add a subdivision surface modifier, and then we'll crank that up to 5. You can probably do it to 4 or higher or lower depending on what RAM you've got. And then we want to add a displacement modifier. There we go. And now we're going to go to the material. Now we've already got our material with the image on it. So what we need to do is click plus and add another material, click new. So there you got a blank material there. And we're gonna click on texture. Now this texture will be the texture for that second material. So you add new, and it by default, it gives you this clouds. So if we click on that bar there, where it says clouds, and go to image or movie, And this is where we're going to add our displacement modifier. So if we go into desktop, and there it says disp. And if I go to the preview again, we can see it's the black and white one there, the displacement modifier, and I open that up. So then we've got that texture in there now, but we haven't used it yet. So if we go back over to this little wrench, and we come up in the displacement modifier, and we click on the little texture pane there, and now we can click on our texture. You can see it's the black and white one there. You can name it whatever you like. We've just got it as texture. Now what will happen is it will go mental. There you go. See, it has gone mental. So under direction, you click Z. Don't worry about the mentalness for now. And then under texture coordinates, click UV. Now this has put it exactly how it should line up with the image. So then we go to strength, and one is pretty damn high. So we're going to put 0.07. That's just the way I want to do it. It might be a bit too high. No, that looks pretty much. Basically, now you've got the three-dimensional texture of the image that you've put onto this plane. So you can see there, that's the 3D version of, and if I just click on the texture viewer, it's having a think about it. There you go. And now there's our image laid out on top of the three-dimensional version of it. Okay, so we'll go back to solid so it doesn't take up too much space. And if you like, you can add smooth shading and it'll round it off a bit more. Personally, I like the flat shading because it looks less covered in light and it also shows all the sharp little edges up a bit more. But obviously you don't need to do that. So then if we go back to materials and we click on our, well, this is our, basically our 3D material, turn the specularity down, it won't be as shiny. Perhaps we need to go over to the other texture and do it there. It won't be as shiny, and same with the diffuse, turn that down. There you go. It just doesn't look so plasticky and round then. Okay, so we'll press 0 to go into our camera view, and then I'm going to go to my render settings, which is this little camera picture there, and I'm going to turn up the percentage to 100, so it's full quality, and I've got it set to 1920 by 1080, which is full HD frames. And now I'm going to click on PNG, and I'm just going to render it just to see what it looks like. And there we go. We have a finished three-dimensional texture instead of just a flat plane with an image on it. Look at that. Okay, so now what we want to do is just have a look around it in a three-dimensional area, and you can see all of the little contours there, and they all correspond to the contours in the image. And there you go, that's the tutorial. That's how you make a three-dimensional plane texture. Hopefully this has been helpful to you. If it has, please subscribe so you can see more. Please click that thumbs up sign to let us know that it has helped you out. And thank you very much for watching Digital Exposure TV.